So first of all, I want to thank the organizers for this wonderful workshop. And I want to talk about a lower bound result with Chandan Saha. So it's joint work with Chandan Saha and Sebastian Tavenas. Chandan is from IISc and Sebastian is right now in my lab at MSR India. So it's a cubic lower bound for depth free circuits, and this is one of the many ways that I will cheat you. It's not really a cubic lower bound, it's a near cubic lower bound. So as you all know, that most polynomials are extremely hard to compute, and we don't have any explicit polynomial which is even moderately hard to compute. And to add insult to injury, even for the simplest non-trivial model of depth three circuits, we don't have a super polynomial lower bound. The best lower bound that we have is a quadratic lower bound that we had was a quadratic lower bound due to Amir and Avi. And the situation is slightly less embarrassing now. It's so, like in many works in this area, it builds on a series of works. So I will describe the previous works to you. And sort of the incremental idea over the previous works is one small thing, one small idea, but it's a very perverted idea. So I will tell you what it is. So let me tell you about depth three circuits. So let me just define it. A depth three circuit looks like this. It's a sum of terms. Every term is a product of degree one polynomials, affine forms. And usually we just assume that all these terms have the same number of affine forms, let's say D. This capital D is often called the formal degree of the circuit. It's the maximum possible degree that such an object can compute. So, and that's usually fine. But we are dealing with only cubic, quadratic kind of lower bounds, and so sometimes I will have to refine this. Sometimes I will say that the ith term has degree di, and sometimes I'll wave my hands and just say d, the formal degree. And we'll assume, without loss of generality, that d1 is at least d2, is at least ds. Yes. So here's the result that I want to present to you today. There exists an explicit family of multilinear polynomials. Fn such that any depth three circuit computing Fn has size at least n cube. Again, it's not really an n cube. So I will brush some polylog factors under the carpet using the tilde notation. It's actually something like n cubed by log square n. Yeah, so Ram Prasad's question is related to this. When we are having only like these polynomial lower bounds, we have to be careful about formulas versus circuits. And so here, to be more precise, the number of distinct linear forms, distinct affine forms, and distinct is distinct up to scalar multiples that occur in this has to be at least n cubed. So okay, so let me give some. So let me start with one folklore observation. I don't know whom to attribute it to. So it's this, that suppose you have a circuit like this which computes a polynomial f. Now what I could do is I could pick one affine form from each of these gates, each of these TIs, and look at f modulo the ideal generated by these forms. And so then that will have to be zero. So let me put it like this. If f is computed by a depth free circuit where the top fanon is S, then the hypersurface okay, I will use Ankit's notation, the variety of f, the set of points on which f vanishes, this contains an n minus s dimensional hyperplane, affine subspace. And the proof is like this. This affine subspace is just pick one linear form from each of these TIs and look at. So each of these LIs will generate a hyperplane. Look at the intersection of these hyperplanes. And there's one detail that I'm again brushing under the rug. I pick one thing from each of the gates. They might not be linearly independent, but let me not worry about this degenerate case for now. It can be handled. So, okay. So I just told you the proof. And now one wants to find a polynomial which does not vanish on any large affine subspace, and it here one can find many such explicit polynomials. For example, the determinantal hypersurface won't contain very large affine subspaces. One can show these kind of things, and that essentially tells you that a polynomial like, for example, the determinant cannot be represented as a depth free circuit no matter what d you allow here, for any d, as long as the top fanon is less than something. In the case of the determinant, it's something like n minus 2. Okay. But okay. So let me go tell you about the next thing. This was covered in the boot camp, but let me just quickly remind you about this. So Nissan and Vikdarsan, sometime in the 90s, they observed the following, that if F can be written as a depth-free circuit like this, where the top fan-in is S and the formal degree is D, then the dimension of the kth order partials of F is at most S times D choose K. Now, this gives us a lower bound in the homogeneous case. So suppose, suppose I take F to be a polynomial in n variables of degree D. So throughout this, F will be my hard polynomial, n will be its number of variables, and small d will be its degree, and big D will be the formal degree of the circuit. Now, so suppose if D was less than n and the formal degree of the circuit was also the degree of the polynomial that you had, then for a polynomial in n variables, you could hope to have, let's say, n choose k many partial derivatives, which are independent, whereas here you have d choose k many things. And so if n is larger than d, you get some nice lower bound. And one thing about this is that this stops working where it stops working when d becomes, the degree of the polynomial becomes large. So let me state the Nissan-Vikdarsan result. If the formal degree of the circuit is equal to d and d is less than equal to 2n, then there exists an explicit f. Which requires let me say much less than n, requires n to the omega d depth free circuits. And you basically this technique doesn't give you anything non-trivial when d approaches 2n, because we know polynomials, we know products of linear forms where this bound is, this d choose k bound is essentially tight. So what Spilka and Vikdarsan, they made the next step in this direction. They sort of combined this with this. With this observation about looking at F modulo large dimensional subspaces. So what they observed is the following. So suppose we are in this quadratic kind of regime where the number of terms is not too many and the formal degree is also not too large, everything is overall the size is quadratic. Then say if the size was significantly subquadratic, the size is the size of the overall circuit, and F is like this, it's a depth free circuit, then there exists n minus m dimensional subspace. You choose m is the parameter that we choose, and I will tell you what choice works in a second. Affine subspace H such that F restricted to this affine subspace H has a depth free circuit where the formal degree is small. And the top fanon is goes down slightly from S to S minus M. Yes. And what's the idea for this? You pick the top M terms. So M, you will choose it to be something like N over 100. So think of M as like N over 100, linear in N. And let's say I have a subquadratic size circuit. So I kill the first n over 100 terms here with the highest formal degrees. And then if the overall size is subquadratic, what we will be left with is a depth free circuit where the formal degree is small, is at most n. And this means that if you have a polynomial such that restricted to every n over 100 dimensional subspace, if its partial derivative space is large, then that polynomial must require a quadratic size depth free circuit. And they gave this gave an explicit polynomial which has this property. In fact, the symmetric elementary symmetric polynomial has this property, and that gave the quadratic lower bound. Okay, I should mention here one more thing. That in our theorem, in the cubic lower bound, this family of polynomials is explicit, but we don't know how to compute it efficiently, and we don't know of any efficiently computable family with the property that we want. It's in VNP. So, I think of VNP as the family of families of explicit polynomials. That's the class. Yes, yes, yeah. So I will give you a polynomial where the coefficients can be computed in polynomial term. Uniformly also. So yeah. So it's explicit in this stronger sense. Yeah. I don't know how to compute these guys, but yeah, I can compute the coefficient. I will describe it. Yeah. Yeah.
It's not known that FN has polysized arithmetic
circuit. Yeah, I would be happy to see this for, let's say, IMM. And I will tell you why we don't know it for IMM currently. So really the heart of our proof is some sort of improvement for the Nissan-Vigdorson theorem, where in the Nissan-Vigdorson theorem we require two things: that the formal degree be small, roughly equal to the degree of the polynomial, and the degree itself should not be much more than the number of variables. So, we improve this by essentially removing this restriction that the degree is small, but the formal degree is still equal to, roughly equal to the degree of the polynomial. Of n variate polynomials of degree d such that any must have the top n in at least 2 to the n, fully exponential bound. This is for any d, so that is a new thing about it. Now, it is the wrong kind of thing to do. We would actually like to allow the formal degree to be anything and get an exponential lower bound. If one can do that, we do not know how to do that, but if one could do that, it would separate Vp from Vnp. We do this instead this other thing where we allow the degree of the polynomial itself to be large, but the formal degree here is you can allow it to be slightly larger than d and you still get an exponential lower bound. So, any questions? Yeah. Sorry, I didn't understand.
In this statement?
Yes.
So, if I tell you that d is...
Yeah. So, think of the d as n cube, for example, here.
So, for this sort of parameter setting, there is a family of
polynomials. Yeah. So, for... So, I should say that if you fix d as a function of n, and then depending on that d, I will have a f. Yeah, it's critical. And in fact, this here, this family here is actually, you can assume it to be some variant of IMM also. So, this family here is efficiently computable. Okay. So, yeah, this is depth reduction to depth 3. So, suppose d was something like, let us say, root n, and you could do it for any formal degree capital D, then roughly n to the root n will even be enough, not even, yeah. Yeah. But the family of polynomials depends on the degree.
So, what is this, I think, formal degree versus degree?
Yeah. So, the degree is the degree of the output of the circuit, and the formal degree is the syntactic degree. In this case, it is the maximum number of affine forms which occur in any Ti here.
You don't take into account the cancellation. In the definition of formal degree.
Yeah.
Size of the resulting depth 4 circuit, if I start out with a size S circuit, is something along the lines of S choose root D plus N choose root D. And in those regimes, when D is much larger, then doesn't that beat this? If D was like N cube, then don't you get an exponential in N to the 3 halves or something?
So there's a bunch of parameters here.
It gives
something for, actually this works even for depth 4 circuits with bounded bottom finite, but it doesn't imply anything spectacular at depth 4. Okay, so I want to actually tell you about this thing, and then the first result will require one small thing. So in order to tell you about this, this builds on Nisan Vikdarsan. So let me just tell you very quickly the proof of how Nisan Vikdarsan goes. So Nisan Vikdarsan used the dimension of partial derivatives of a polynomial as a measure of the complexity of the polynomial. So we look at, for a polynomial f, we look at all its kth order partials and look at the dimension of this. They actually look at all partials, but never mind, we will only look at kth order partials. And there are two properties of this. First of all, subadditivity, so which is the following thing, that this measure for the sum of two polynomials t and t tilde is at most the sum of the measures. And this is very easy to verify, because essentially differentiation is a linear operator. So that's easy. And they also showed if we take a product of d affine forms, then dimension of the kth order partials of such a t is at most d choose k. And and in order to tell you what our thing is, let me just prove this for you. You would have seen this already in the boot camp, but let me do it again nevertheless. So you look at the proof is very explicitly, it gives you a vector space which spans the set of polynomials here. So you look at this set of vector spaces VS, define it to be the product of so S is a subset of D, the product of all the affine forms in the set S. And when you have t equal to L1, L2, Ld, then the kth order partial derivatives of t, they lie in the span of all of the union of all Vs, S is a subset of size d choose d minus k, right? So this is a bit of a stupid thing to do. This is just one polynomial, so this vector space is just all multiples of this polynomial. And this is very easy to verify. Just take derivative, that any kth order derivative is in the linear span of this set of polynomials. So that essentially proves the second claim, and that gives the lower bound due to Nisan and Vikdarsan. So now we had you would have looked at shifted partials, and one tries to apply shifted partials here. So again, this is the setting. Suppose you have a product of affine forms, and once again you define Vs now to be the span of all of guys like this. But now you take this set of polynomials, multiply it by all monomials of degree at most L. And what the technique of shifted partials does is it starts with a polynomial f, it looks at all its derivatives of order k, and it shifts them by monomial of degree L and looks at the span of the set of polynomials. So now now we will apply shifted partials to this. So then the next obvious question to ask is, how large is the, just for clarity, let me call this V tilde S. These are the shifted versions of those vector spaces. How large is this span? We want an upper bound in order to be able to prove lower bounds on depth three circuits. Now, also another okay. So basically, the problem boils down to this: I have a bunch of vector spaces. I want to take their union and say something about the dimension of the span. And it turns out that many of these vector spaces, pairwise, they have a large intersection. So that's why we are hoping to be able to improve this the upper bound that we had previously. And so what's a natural thing to try to do? Try to apply some sort of inclusion exclusion. It's sort of like a union of sets. You want to upper bound the cardinality. Unfortunately, inclusion exclusion fails for vector spaces. It's not true. And so this natural thing doesn't work, or at least I don't know how to make it work. And it's conceivable that some better estimates will give you much improved lower bounds. So that's why I wanted to mention this. What we do is something very stupid and, in hindsight, very simple. And to explain this, let me consider this. Let's say D is NQ. So and oh, okay, sorry, not D, but the formal degree is, let's say, NQ. And we have a product of D affine forms. So this is a product of N cube many affine forms. We think of this guy as a product of polynomials of degree N square in N variables. Now, it seems like a very perverse thing to do, because this guy has very low complexity. It's like complexity n to the 4. But if you take a polynomial of degree n square in n variables, it has extremely, a general polynomial of degree n square in n variables has extremely high complexity. It has objects in it which are VNP complete, which are exponentially, which we believe are exponentially hard to compute. Nevertheless, this simple thing works. This simple thing gives some upper bound on this dimension. So let me just state it. So and you would have seen this before in when in the boot camp, but just let me repeat this now. So what you do is you choose first T, and it will be something like d by n in general. And I'm in the homogeneous setting where capital D is also small d. I'm ignoring some polylog factors. And now you just view it, rewrite. So now take the first t linear affine forms and call them as some polynomial q1, q2, and so on, q d by t, where degree of qi, right? We just rewrote our thing like this. And now we go back and apply the previous shifted power partials upper bound that we know. So let me state that. Then the dimension of the shifted partials of t is at most and many of you will have seen this, but just in case you haven't, let me just quickly tell you how this happens. So this time let me go here. Oh, actually it's easier for me to reuse this. So this time let me call Vs tilde as these guys, products, shifts of I will need slightly different Vs. Yes, and so and it turns out that the span of the kth order partials of t is contained in the span of the union of Vs tilde. So S here is a subset of the QIs of size d by t minus k. Yes. Yes.
But you could also sort of say that no, I'm going to take, let's say, R of these Li, multiply them out together, and absorb them into the monomial. So I can think of them as something that looks like, I mean, n plus L plus R choose n times d choose k plus R. And this is just that you have to choose your k to make sure that. Is that another way of getting a very similar bound?
Maybe.
Gain something by having
zero. I mean, implicitly you are extending. If you take these derivatives, if you take the derivatives of the QIs, they're going to be like products of the LIs. At that point, you just say, well, they're actually just loaded
degree. I think it's an alternate way of doing it. It's the same. Because how do you prove this thing? Right? You take a derivative of qi.
I mean, okay, intuitively the thing is this, right? I mean, the number of subsets of capital T is way more than the number of monomials that are present in if I expand it out completely, because then that's really the...
So, I'm not fast enough to think about alternate approaches. Let me just explain why, give some more intuition about this. So let me just state what this implies. This implies that this is at most d by t choose k times somewhere we had written this for one term, n plus l plus kt choose n. So another way to think about it maybe is this. The naive way would be just take t equal to 1. Yeah. The natural way would be just to take t equal to 1. And so basically we have these two binomial coefficients. They are both of them grow exponentially. Both of them are sort of competing with each other, and what for a long time basically it didn't occur to us to balance out these two binomial coefficients, and basically you choose t such that the product is as small as possible. That's all that we are doing.
K times t should be something like L, I guess, right, or something like that.
This guy?
Yeah, K times t is going to be something like L?
No, much larger.
Much larger.
Yeah. So, t will be like roughly, as I said, somewhere roughly d by n. Yeah, it's a. So, if you were to pretend that these are just products of polynomials of so much degree, whatever is the natural value of L that you choose, that is the value of L that we have, essentially. So something like N. Yeah. K will be about n, so say n over 100. Yeah. Oh, yeah, so maybe I should mention t will be like d by n and k will be like n over 100. Some small constant times n. And yeah, so I'm in this setting where small d and big D are the same. The homogeneous setting for now. Okay, and so essentially now if you use this upper bound for the circuit, we know of also explicit polynomials, efficiently computable polynomials where the shifted partial dimension is very large. There's one small thing here. Now the degree is n cube, but it turns out in this regime of parameters also the known constructions essentially work with some modification. And then if you choose your parameters carefully, and which I didn't tell you all the parameters, but and then compare the shifted partials of f with this upper bound, optimize your parameters, you get a 2 to the n lower bound. So yeah, sorry I waved my hands here, but the rest is relatively straightforward from this point onwards. So now, no. So the question is about the explicit polynomial. I don't know if that works, but basically you take the Nissan-Wigderson polynomial, raise every variable to a suitable power, and that works. Yeah, it can't be multilinear. Okay. So now we want to go back to the earlier thing, where the formal degree of the circuit is not equal to, can be significantly more than the degree of the polynomial. In that case, so basically from what we do here, from this thing, one gets the following, that there exists an explicit f such that of degree d on n variables such that if the formal degree of the circuit computing f is much less than n times d. So let me abuse some notation here. So it's smaller than n d by even polylog factors, then the top fanin must be super polynomial. So let me say, so as long as the formal degree is substantially less than the product of n times d, we get a super polynomial lower bound. So and this is where sort of the improvement comes. So then we just combine it with the earlier observation, just like Spilka and Wigderson did. We generalize that idea. So in particular, what this means is the following. So suppose now we now want to go back and try to prove cubic lower bounds for depth three circuits. So and the size of this circuit is strictly subcubic. Then then there exists an m-dimensional affine subspace H such that f restricted to H has small partial has a small shifted partial. So the small is really an exponential quantity, but it was somewhat non-trivial. And this m here will be, like before, something like n over 100. Sorry, n minus n over 100. And just like before, we just, the idea for this is order the terms by their degree from the heaviest terms, from the first m heaviest terms, pick one affine form each, and that corresponds to a hyperplane, and this affine subspace is just the intersection of these hyperplanes. So, and the reason this works like before is because we are looking at this very cubic, quadratic, very small polynomial kind of regimes. So, if the size is small, then the least heavy terms will have formal degree at most n square, somewhat less than n square. And that's why this works. And now we are almost done. So this essentially, so this implies that for any polynomial which has this property, that if you restrict it to an affine subspace of so much dimension, if its shifted partial is large, then it requires cubic sized depth 3 circuits. And now the only question is to construct such an polynomial, an explicit polynomial which has this property. And this is the only place where where something like IMM, we don't know whether it works or not. And so let's think about it, how one might prove such a thing. Proving that shifted partials for some polynomial is large already requires this some work, and we don't know really how to prove such things very well. We can do it in some cases. So there is this family of Nissan-Wigderson polynomials for which we do know how to prove that its shifted partials is large. So let me just write down first the corollary for any f such that f restricted to H has large shifted partials for every H of dimension so much of dimension m, f requires cubic depth 3 circuits. Okay, so this one, and again one more very stupid idea that works. So let's see what going modulo or restricting F to a affine subspace would mean. Essentially, up to a change of variables, what are we doing when we restrict F to an affine subspace? We are doing something like this. We are replacing the first n minus m variables by linear forms in the other variables, or affine forms in the other variables. So maybe I replace x1 by some affine form in xm plus 1 through xn. Similarly, for every the first m variables, I replace it by affine forms in the other variables. And then I look at f, I replace the first m variables by these affine forms, and the rest of the variables remain as it is. And I want to essentially show that no matter what L1 tildes you pick, this polynomial has high shifted partials. And well, suppose our polynomial f was a Nissan-Wigderson polynomial which did not depend at all on the first m variables, then this transformation has done nothing to it at all, right? And so, so this will just work. I could just choose my f to be a Nissan-Wigderson which does not depend on the first m variables. But of course, the trouble is that in general, I don't know whether I have to substitute the first m variables or not. So finally, we sort of patch together a bunch of Nissan-Wigderson polynomials using some more additional variables, such that after doing such a substitution and setting these additional variables to some suitable values, 0, 1 values, I essentially get back a Nissan-Wigderson polynomial. So
you need to set a bunch of high rank things, like high degree things to be, right?
Yes.
Then you want to, so you have for the remaining part, if the formal degree is empty, then you have
So the for let's say n to the 4 size circuit and
capital D to be
empty. Yeah, so I'm thinking of D as being, we are in the multilinear regime, so D is at most n. More generally, if you allow polynomials of degree D where D is larger than n, the lower bound that you get is essentially n square times D up to polylog factors.
So improving this statement, this proposition where capital D can now be some larger function of n.
Yeah, yes, will improve the bound. Yeah, that's it. We can write it down, but we don't know how to compute it efficiently. In this last step where I said you put together a bunch of So this NW could be replaced by IMM, but we sort of put them together using a bunch of additional variables. And that step is the one which is non-explicit. Oh no. No, we didn't try. Thank you.